the next session, which will mainly focus about EPC, project development, and system integration technologies, talking about contracting, legal, commercial, and taxation aspects, the design and engineering aspects, the procurement methods, use of drones, trackers, IoT, and advanced analytics, and definitely the challenges like grid, land, construction issues, etc. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm honored to invite Mr. Abhishek Tulsiyan, procurement head from Juniper Green Energy, as our session chair and moderator. Mr. Abhishek Tulsiyan, Mr. Dheeraj Malani, head business development EPC North and West region from Mahindra Sustain, Mr. Animesh, head for Delhi and NCR region from Godrej and Boys, Mr. Vikas Arya, he's from Jackson, Mr. Abhijit from Bosch, Ma'am Ritulal from Amplus, we have Mr. Harish Ahuja from India Go Solar, Mr. Vikas Arya from Jackson, Mr. Akesh Khanna, Managing Director, Indian Subcontinent and the Southeast Asian region for SMA Solar Inverters. Ladies and gentlemen, let's welcome them with a big round of applause.
Thanks, EQ, for this opportunity and inviting all of us in a single platform. We have a mix of EPC, two EPC companies, one inverter manufacturer, and India Bulls developer, and also a funding company. Giving this opportunity is good. I represent Juniper Green Energy Private Limited. We are IPPs. We are developing solar power projects. And to start with, the topic is EPC developer and system integration technology. So we are essentially developing solar power plants. Solar power is being basically utility scale projects. In utility scale project, we have different methodologies for doing EPC. Either we can give single turnkey EPC or we can split the contracts. So taking this forward, I would request Dheeraj to put some insight into EPC strategies. And the first topic, contracting, legal, commercial, taxation aspects.
EPC story is very interesting if you see in the solar. We started with small scale projects of 5-10 megawatt in somewhere 7-8 years back. Typically those were the known solar park based projects. Then industry move on and scale increases. Solar park based projects and to the tune of 50, 100 or 250 megawatt came into picture. Now again the industry is slightly falling back towards known solar park based ISTS projects, where the change is the connectivity, that instead of state transmission utility connectivity, you are shifting towards central transmission utility connectivity. And in a time frame of 18 months, you have to complete the entire stuff right from the land identification, conversion, and then your EPC procurement, each and every aspect. So that's, I think, is the challenging part, where EPC is playing a very good role. Although the dynamics are not in favor of the EPC players, because then I'll touch upon the first part of the topic, the taxation and other stuff. If you see post GST, there was a big dilemma that what is the GST rate applicable on the solar PV ground mounted projects. Then some addition came from the government, and again, I believe the dilemma is still prevailing, because there is interpretation between the lines and there is opinions taken from the specified firms based on it. EPC players are taking a role, a part into the contracts with respect to the GST portion. But for the industry, this kind of dilemma with respect to GST, taking different stake by the different EPC players in different contracts formatting, not in favor of the entire industry as a whole. So that's one of the challenge I would like to highlight here, that everybody has to be on the same platform with respect to the GST rate applicable on the solar PV projects. Contracting can be one contract or several or whatever be that, that's a different thing, but the rate at least should be the same. So developers are also here, and they would appreciate that once the bid is over or they win the bid, then most of the stuff we want to dump over the shoulders of the EPC player. So technical side it is okay, scope side it is also okay. But if you see the kind of pressure which an EPC player is facing today in the solar industry, the kind of big volumes of a single project is there into the industry, it is not possible for him to take the entire risk on his shoulders of the GST, of the delays and of other aspects as well. There is a partnership needed between the developer and the EPC player to take these big scale projects upward in a better fashion. On the design aspects, several changes have happened in the industry. We have moved from 2-winding transformer to a 5-winding transformer. We have moved from 1 megawatt block size to a 12.5 megawatt block size, and I think further moving towards a 20 megawatt block size kind of stuffs. Structures, there is a big change happened, and I think Vikas can populate that part very well, that the kind of tonnage which was used somewhere 3-4 years, 5 years back, and the kind of MMS tonnage which we are using today, we have to be very, very cautious that things should not go wrong in the lifespan of the solar PV projects. Then there is lot many things happening on the O&M front as well, from wet cleaning to dry cleaning. That's kind of very interesting industry developing within the country, that the kind of dry cleaning system are developed, the kind of robots are developed, and lot many innovations happening. It is more possible to optimize on that front, on the cost part as well as the performance part. So I think that's something I have started the EPC discussions, and you can take it forward.
Thanks, Dheeraj, for setting the tune. Basically, as a developer, we look to divide contracts, either we look to give it on turnkey basis. When you give a turnkey contract, all the equipments including module, inverter, structures, and your civil works falls in single contract. In general practice, now developers are dividing contracts into two parts, even if they are going for EPC. In general, they are separating module and giving the rest of BOS EPC. And the GST regime, the GST notification which has come in December, that clearly mentioned 70% on 70% of the total value of the project, there is applicability of 5% GST. And on rest 30%, there is applicability of 18% GST. So it comes around 8.9%. So the basic issue which I face as a developer, how to structure my contracts. Means if I give only a single contract, then we have a exposure, we have a clarity that it is 8.9. Otherwise, if we split it, suppose I separate module, whether the BOS will again be same, will be governed by the same regime, GST rulings, or whether it will be a difference. Also, in the same circular, chapter 84, 85 and 94 has been defined under solar power generating system, you will have 5% GST. So again, if I am trying to procure cables only, these cables falls on the, under these chapters, but when I am asking cable supplier to give me 5% GST, they are not clear. They are saying we will take this kind of declaration, we will take this format, we will take this undertaking from you. Again, they are saying ki it will take some time for my refund to come back, so we will incur interest cost. So these are all practical aspects which as a developer I am feeling. And when you are bidding for projects, you generally go by rule book. Rule book says 5% GST. So you will in your costing consider 5% GST. But when you are actually trying to build a project, your actual cost may differ because of these practical issues. So as Dheeraj mentioned, we need clarity on GST. This is the first point as a developer which I feel, because then you can structure your contracts in right way, or you can plan your procurement to in right way so that your exposures to tax is minimum, or you can plan it in advance. And as a developer, we don't have any input GST credit mechanism, because on electricity which we are selling to DISCOMs, there is no taxation. So whatever GST as a developer we are paying is a cost to us. So government need to look into this and help developers so that this small rule or small change in structuring can bring down the cost drastically, which I feel. Another thing, if you go with module contracts are basically from China. Most of the developers try to procure modules from China. There are Indian developers also now, from India procurement is also happening. If you are procuring modules from China, you need to hedge your Forex, because Forex is fluctuating. 2-3 months back, it touched around 72, now it went to 68. So there is a Forex risk, and you need to give contracts for that to hedge your Forex risk. In module contracts, you need to define arbitration very clearly. In case of any disputes, you need to define where the arbitration will happen. And you need to try to cover your module warranties backed by BGs for a limited time period. So these are the major contracting, legal, commercial taxation aspects which I feel as a developer. Now, I would request Mr. Rakesh sir, to put some light on it.
Actually, I am from the inverter manufacturing side, but I'm very happy to be in this panel. And, some of the points which were raised by my previous speakers in terms of, jurisdictions, in terms of taxation and related things. So we though we are an inverter manufacturer, and we participate in all kinds of projects, whether they are large ground-mounted projects or rooftop projects. We have been listening to these insights very carefully and have been configuring our company to suit the EPC companies and the developers. To give you examples, now, we have started offering all our product range from 1st of April in Indian rupees. So all the hedging part of it, what the developers or the EPC companies had to do, all that responsibility has been removed from their shoulders. So they can do contracting with us in Indian rupees. To give you another example, how we are becoming more and more local for our customers in India, we have changed the jurisdictions. Now they can do the transactions with us in SMA India. That means the jurisdiction is India. That means we are in the same land, we follow the same law of the land. And that helps a lot. As we heard in the previous speakers, there were some issues when there were some Chinese companies which defaulted, and then it was very difficult, even though the case was won, to get the compensation or whatever was the decision of the court or the arbitrators. So those things also we are covering now. So number one, in terms of hedging, we have removed that hurdle from our customers, whether they are EPCs, whether they are developers. Number two, in terms of jurisdictions, we have come to the same terms as is required by our customers. And number three, let's talk a little bit about some of the things which were mentioned in terms of, as a EPC, today the scope of work varies. In certain projects you do DC side, certain projects you do complete scope of work, and sometimes you do also operation and maintenance. It is no more like that you get a contract and you finish your activities and after 1 or 2 years you have come out of the site. Many of the EPCs are doing value adds in terms of offering O&M contracts, in terms of offering complete solution and offering to their customers that whatever throughput or yield is needed will be achieved and it will be locally done. So we have even configured ourselves to achieve that. You know, we are able to offer the spare parts in Indian rupees. We are conforming extended warranties up to 20 years, you know, from the after 5 years. That means for 25 years, you can buy SMA warranties. There are very few manufacturers in the world in inverters who offer such warranties. Most of them maximum will go up to 10 years. They have no ideas on how the technology transfer takes place and how the re-engineering has to be done, where again we have put a lot of efforts locally as well as globally to achieve those things. Then in terms of, there was a, talk on the block sizes. Depending on the site locations, depending on the size of the project, different block locations are selected. Different configurations are selected. Flexibilities are needed in terms of how the installation of the different products would happen. So all those things are also taken care in our new design and technologies. We are offering different types of installations. In terms of one of the key features, what we offer is what we call it as outdoor inverters. They are real outdoors. You don't need a canopy or anything also on it. And these locations are flexible. As you are doing the engineering, you can decide where you want to put your inverters. If you go with a control room design, an indoor inverter design, many things get fixed. And in case a change is needed, it becomes really difficult. So these are some of the examples of how we are also listening to our customers, whether they are EPCs, whether they are developers, and coming up with solutions to give the best out of the investments what they do with us. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Indeed, if we are getting INR pricing, that reduces the forex risk. And if you are getting 20 years warranty, that is a good thing, because inverters are, our next session is inverters, heart of every solar PV system. So if heart is 20 years warranted, that's great. So now I would request Ms. Ritu Lal to give her insights on contracting, legal, commercial, and taxation.
Thank you. First of all, apologies for being a little late to the party. We work as a developer. So we are the EPC, we are the project owners, and we are the ones who will maintain the project for the life of that project. So most of our PPAs are 25 years, some are 20, there'll be a few odd that are 15 years. So for us, three things are very important. From the, not from the commercial side of the business, which is, you know, client rating and all, but from the solar plant and technology point of view. The first is obviously the equipment, the watt that we are using. And we are using top-notch modules. We have been buying top-notch inverters, probably across sites. I think the maximum number of inverters that we have are from SMA. So, and it doesn't stop there. We're very, very careful with design of structures. You know, unlike an inverter or a module which comes to you assembled and branded, structures are slightly more complicated, but have a lot of repercussions if you go wrong there. Other than that, there's cables and, you know, there's about 20 other materials that is there. So one is on the material. The second is the integration aspect. I could get everything which is top-notch. And if I do not integrate it properly, if I miss out on the design feature, it is a damage that cannot be undone. You know, once I have completed and set up the plant, to kind of undo it is probably worse than, you know, it probably makes sense to junk that plant and start all over again. And that is an impossibility because I'm working on a rooftop. Because I work for industrial and commercial segments, I cannot destroy somebody's rooftop and say, okay, this rooftop I've bungled up. Let me give me another rooftop where I'll put up a plant properly. So how you put it together is very important. One, in the designing. Second, also in the construction phase. So much damage, and those of you who represent module manufacturers, particularly in the room, how much damage is done while laying the modules? People sit on them, there are micro cracks, the transportation is not done properly, the stacking is not done properly. You know, at least inverters, that problem is very mitigated. And now that you're telling me that you have inverters which are designed to be, you know, put on 50 degree rooftops without even a canopy on top of it, that's great. Because so far what we've been advocating to our clients is give us some room, some wall space. We don't even want floor space. Anywhere which is indoors, give us anything where we mount it on the wall. We're not going to take much space. It is for your good because this inverter will last longer. Right. So if I have an inverter which can withstand 60 degrees temperature on the rooftop, which is what rooftops get to if the atmospheric temperature is around 45-50, that is excellent. But modules still are the most delicate part of this system. I can buy the right module, I can have a right design, everything, but if the handling of that module during the construction stage is not ideal, the plant will suffer. So that's the second. Then the third aspect that we come to is the maintenance and the operations part of it. Having done everything correctly, if I do not maintain, it will not perform. Forget it will not perform, it will start decaying. You know, the structures will start decaying and the modules will again start not performing. So it's performing maintenance plus performing maintenance correctly. Here again, you would have, it's very, very common for people to use harsh brushes, scrubs, solvents, all of which I suppose are a strict no-no from the structure side as well as from the module side, because they're causing a lot of damage. So these are the, you know, operational challenges that we face. Other than that, of course, on the taxation regulatory side, and I'm sure a lot of that has already been thrashed out, there's not much we can do apart from represent and say, you know, simplify things and specify things. What category do you, 5%, 18%, what, when, why, specify it. I will not end. It's not my domain, right? It's none of our domains. In its wisdom, makes a decision, but stick to a decision and have clarity. And I think all of us, this is what we've been challenging them, right? Have clarity, do not do about turns. So the one worry that we have is not so much about what it is today. It's about the sanctity of it. Will it remain what it is? Will the entire evaluation today, that 70-30 formula has been, thrown out at us? Will that change? When will it change? Will it suddenly be done with retrospective effect? Then all of us will go scrambling and, somebody will go to APTEL, somebody will go to some high court, which is not my core business, right? Other than keeping lawyers in business, that is not helpful to me. It is distracting and it is expensive. So on the regulatory side, I'm really, done challenging the merits and demerits of safeguard duty and does it work, does it not work? Let the government take a call on what they think is there. But we need to have some sort of long-term stability. I'm not saying that whatever you've announced today cannot change in the next 20 years. We're a very dynamic country. But whatever changes you effect should only apply on newer projects. Just to give you an example, today you have decided that the sale of solar power does not attract, rooftop solar does not attract electricity duty or some other taxes or whatever it is. If you tomorrow change your mind and say no, sale of solar power will attract certain taxes and duties, fair enough. Don't make it apply to plants which are already operational. So that there is a difference between retrospective and this also, right? Retrospective means from a back date. But today you can tell me from 1st of the next month, your existing PPAs will all attract tax. That will also become very difficult for a developer. So whatever changes you effect should start on that day going forward. If we have this little clarity, it will become very easy to do business.